What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Since the invention of the internet, applications and web pages rely on one main simple idea, the transfer of data from one place to another. So, say you're looking at a picture on Instagram, this picture is most probably being fetched from a server then loaded back into the application, making it possible for you to view it. And one way this communication is made possible is via REST APIs. Now, before diving into what REST is, let's first answer what APIs are. You see, API stands for Application Programming Interface, and it's the intermediary that allows two applications to talk to each other. Take Booking.com as an example. This website allows you to book flights and hotel rooms in all parts of the world via several agencies in any means you want. But how does this single website or application have access to all this information? How does it have access to every reserved room in every hotel and every flight around the world? You see, these hotels do not expose their client information. They do not grant Booking.com access to their database, of course. What they do instead is provide them with an API, a means of communication that takes in a request and returns with a response. So what Booking.com does is send a request via an API to a particular hotel you picked, asking it if rooms are available on that certain date, for example, and that API will return with the result you will be able to deal with and render on your browser or mobile application. That's what APIs are. They're basically the waiters of our restaurants, who as a first step take clients' or customers' requests and send them to the server or chef to be processed and then return with the response or food we are expecting. Now, APIs can conform to many architectural styles. One of them, and by far the most popular, is the REST architectural style. You see, REST stands for Representational State Transfer, and it defines a set of rules or principles that help you create web APIs. In a client-server communication, REST suggests that when certain data is requested by a client, the server should represent this data by an object, and the values of this object returned will represent the state or response the client is asking for. This style helps leveraging the bandwidth, making it ideal for transferring data via the internet. A few seconds ago, we mentioned that REST defines a set of principles. But what are these principles? Well, there are six main principles laid down by Dr. Fielding, who was the one to define the REST API design in the year 2000. First, we have the client-server separation principle. Under REST architecture, the client and server can only interact in one way. The client sends a request to the server, then the server sends a response back to the client. Servers cannot make requests, and clients cannot respond. All interactions are initiated by the client. This pattern enforces separation of concerns, which helps the client and the server components evolve independently, meaning client code can grow without worrying about affecting any other servers, and server code can be modified without affecting clients. The second principle is the uniform interface or contract. You see, to decouple a client from the server, you need to have a unified interface that permits autonomous development of the application without tightly coupling its services, models, and actions to the API layer. This enhances the visibility of interaction between our clients and the server and allows us to easily state what our clients have access to and what we can provide them with. Next is the layered system principle. REST API's architecture includes several layers that operate together to construct a hierarchy that helps generate a more scalable and flexible application. A layered application has better security, as components in each layer can't interact outside the subsequent layer, leading to overall stability in the application. Next, APIs should be stateless. This means that calls can be made independent of one another. Moreover, every call includes the data essential to complete itself only and effectively. In other words, every request sent from the client to the server must include all the info needed to comprehend that request and that request only. Additionally, APIs should be cacheable. You see, a stateless API may have to manage huge loads of calls and data. Therefore, a REST API design should store cacheable data. Data within a response should be categorized as cacheable or non-cacheable. If a response is cacheable, the client cache is provided the right to recycle that response data for similar requests in the future. Finally, the last constraint we have is code on demand. This one is optional and is used the least. This REST principle allows for coding or applets to be communicated through the API used within the application. It permits a client code or applet to be downloaded and to be used within the application. It streamlines clients by decreasing the number of features essential to be pre-implemented. Okay, now that we know what REST is and why we should be using it, let's look at how we can do that. You see, REST determines the structure of an API, as we previously mentioned, and developers are obliged to a specific set of rules when designing an API. For instance, I assume you've all heard of the CRUD operations when dealing with databases: create, read, update, and delete. Well, these actions are the main drivers behind REST APIs, which leverage HTTP methods and are the same as the REST methods. You'll make use of the GET method to fetch or request data from a server, the PUT method to alter or update the state of data such as an object, a file, or record, the POST method to create or insert data, and finally the DELETE method to eliminate or delete data. However, this does not mean that REST and HTTP are the same. You shouldn't confuse these two together. You see, even though REST also intends to make the web more streamlined and standard, Roy Fielding in his dissertation has nowhere mentioned any implementation or included any protocol preference such as HTTP. So, if you are following the six guideline principles of REST, we can call our interface RESTful. Okay, to sum everything up, in the REST architectural style, data used is considered a resource, and resources are acted upon by using a set of simple, well-defined operations, methods, and principles which help RESTful applications be simple, lightweight, and fast. Also, the resources must be decoupled from their representation so that clients can access the content in various formats such as XML, JSON, and many others. The clients and servers exchange representations of resources by using a standardized interface and protocol. Typically, HTTP is the most used protocol, but REST does not mandate it. Stay tuned for upcoming videos of the series in which we will introduce Spring Boot and start creating our own REST APIs. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.